Good day to you. This is Sunday morning, and we're here to study God's Word and talk about the Word of God itself. Hopefully, you have your Bible handy. We're going to look at some of the lesson of the hour today. We'll look at the Bible and the Scriptures concerning a lesson about the voice of Jesus. So we think about what that might have sounded like, and we often may wonder, what did the voice of Jesus sound like? Was it a deep voice? Was it a voice that thundered, or was it someone who was soft-spoken and easy to get along with in some regard? As we think about hearing the voice of Jesus in the lesson of the hour. Our lesson text is from John chapter 5, verses 28 and 29. Here the Bible says, "Do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming which all who are in the tombs will hear his voice and will come forth, those who did the good deeds to the resurrection of life, and those who committed the evil deeds to resurrection of judgment." And simply put, as we understand, when Jesus comes back, we're going to physically, all of us, hear the voice of Jesus. And so we might wonder what that sounds like. It might be interesting, but I want to tell you that this is one of the things about this lesson today. It's the kind of voice we want to listen to that makes the matter everything of importance. It's how Jesus speaks to us in the matter of our lives. I want to suggest, first of all, that Jesus is the voice of instruction. And he's the one who teaches us how to live, how to do the things that we ought to do in life and the spiritual way, how to serve God and worship in spirit and in truth correctly. As God wants us to know the things of his ways and follow the paths of Jesus as he's that master teacher that we follow today. In Matthew 5, verses 1 and 2, the Bible tells us, before the Sermon on the Mount, that famous sermon of his, the Bible tells us, verse 1, when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. He opened his mouth and began to teach them, saying, and you look at chapters 5, 6, and 7, and that's really what the Sermon on the Mount consists of, chapters 5, 6, and 7 of Matthew. And they teach a lot of things that the Bible wants us to know. Think about the beginning of this. How that the blessed are those who are the poor in spirit, as verse 3 tells us, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. And he goes on to say about the Beatitudes as the platform of this kingdom. Blessed are those who mourn, blessed are the gentle, the merciful, the pure in heart, the peacemakers. All of those things we're supposed to be. And that's the voice of instruction speaking to us. He talks about in many ways the how we're supposed to interact in the world, be the salt and the light. Verse 13, you're the salt of the earth. And in verses 16 and verse 15 talks about how we're that lampstand. We are the light of the world, verse 16 tells us. That city that's set on a hill cannot be hid. And so there's many things he instructs us in and how that he's teaching us to be different, not have hypocrisy in our lives. Don't do like the hypocrites do. They pray and they stand forth on the street corner. They are very proud of their donations and such. He said, do not let your right hand know what your left hand is doing. He talks about our interpersonal relationships with one another. And he talks about how if you have a sin problem or a fence between you and your brother, simply lay your gift down and go be reconciled. Then offer your gift to your brother. But also he tells us even don't lust. Don't look upon a woman to lust after her because you've committed adultery already, verse 28 tells us, in your heart. That there's a heart problem that can happen if we can't just say or think anything we want to. And so as long as I haven't done this physically, then I'm okay. What all Jesus says goes beyond that. It's a heart problem even to conceive and to dwell upon lust and sinful thoughts. And there's a lot of things the Bible speaks about here. Things he corrects in chapter 6 and 7 about what you've heard from in the past. But I say unto you, talks about marriage, divorce, remarriage. In verse 32, the Bible even tells us, but I say to you that everyone who divorces his wife, except for the reason of unchastity, makes her commit adultery. And whoever marries a divorced woman commits adultery. In other words, the one who's been put away, that is the problem. With that, Jesus says that's adultery when you do that. And so Jesus is the voice of instruction, how to live. And we need to take everything he says, live by all the words that God has for us in his book today. And the Bible tells us that he taught while he was here on this earth, that he went around traveling. And the Bible even tells us in Mark chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, he began to teach again by the sea. And that was his mode of operation, simply going everywhere. And as he was a traveling evangelist or rabbi, you might think of it that way. And he says, and such a very large crowd gathered to him, that he got into a boat in the sea and sat down. And the whole crowd was by the sea on the land. And he was teaching them many things in parables. That's one of the ways Jesus taught, was in parables. And he was to conceal and reveal those kind of things, the hidden truths of God, to those who really didn't want to find out, to seek further and say, well, what does this mean? It might be to also to some make them curious and even go beyond that curiosity and dig deeper for the truths of God and find the truth in the midst of the parable. It talks about all of his teaching, was saying to them in his teaching. That's what Jesus did. He taught while he was here on this earth. In Mark chapter 6, verse 34, the Bible says, when Jesus went ashore, he saw a large crowd, and he felt compassion for them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. He began to teach them many things. So that goes that voice of instruction again, where he's telling the people many things. Incidentally, that's when he fed the 5,000. That they were a great crowd. Can you imagine listening or having people listen to you if you were a preacher or a teacher? A Bible's teacher, to have 5,000 people, that's a great amount of people here, and we don't have that oftentimes every Sunday. That's something that just would happen because Jesus is the master teacher. He's the one who's teaching those large multitudes. But he also teaches us, as God would tell us, to go out and make disciples. In other words, you teach all the nations. You teach them to command them to observe all things that I've commanded you, as verse 20 tells us. Read the verse. It says, go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptize in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I command you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That says a lot about what we're to do. Our job is in that great commission is to go out and preach the gospel to others. It's not our words they're following, but as Jesus, he's still instructing us. When you pick up the gospel of Mark and Matthew and Luke and John, these four gospels are still teaching us. Jesus is still instructing us how to live and how not to live, even in this kingdom age that we're talking about today, and putting God a priority. Matthew 6:33, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. That's still the voice of instruction teaching us today. But Jesus has the voice of authority to us. Now, I may be dating myself just a little bit, but when I was growing up, I used to hear on actually the radio and even television, I'd watch the commercial for E.F. Hutton. And they would say, somebody would say, well, E.F. Hutton says this. And that's really the point of the commercial was when E.F. Hutton talks, people listen. Why? Because he was the voice of authority when it comes to money making. And that's really what he was an investor, a kind of firm where you put your money, he actually tells you how to invest your money. And he was the one you go to for that. If you want financial advice, that's the person to listen to. But when it comes to God and his ways, Jesus, he is the voice of authority. That's the one we go to today, not to somebody else, but to Jesus himself. In Matthew 7, verse 28 and 29, tells us right after the Sermon on the Mount, the reaction, if you will, that took place to hearing all the words from chapters 5, 6, and 7. Verse 28 tells us, when Jesus had finished these words, the crowds were amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority and not as their scribes. Now, that's different than the scribes. Jesus was doing something scribes weren't doing. He was actually saying, but I say unto you. And that's exactly how they noticed that different. In how the scribes and so on, this is what the book of God and the Old Testament would say. They would point to the scriptures, the word of God, and they were right for doing so. But Jesus was the word made flesh. And he was the one who actually was speaking the words of God directly. There was no middleman. There was no one having to write down words by inspiration. But Jesus was the one when he spoke, was the word of God, actually the voice of authority from God himself as he was speaking. That's different, isn't it, than the way the scribes were doing the things. In Mark chapter 1, verses 21 and 22 talks about that noticeable change there. I want to notice what the passage of Scripture says about that particular one. Mark chapter 1, verse 21 says, "They went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, he entered the synagogue and began to teach." In verse 22, "They were amazed at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one having authority and not as the scribes." Now, I want you to think about that. I just read that from Matthew chapter 7, but that was the Sermon on the Mount. Here, Jesus is going into the synagogues in his teaching. We may not pick that up if we are casual in our studies, but if we think about that for a moment, that's two separate different occasions. And so Jesus, wherever he went, was amazing people by his authority, the way he was speaking with authority about the Word of God and all the things the Bible teaches. In verse 27, the Bible says, "They were amazed so that they debated themselves, saying, 'What is this? A new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him.'" Jesus, with his voice, could command the unclean spirits out. He could even stop the winds and all the storms by saying, "Peace, be still," on another occasion. And so Jesus had the voice of authority. His power was in his voice of authority, wasn't it? In Matthew chapter 21, verses 27 to 29, they questioned Jesus' authority. And he had already cast out the money changers, those people who were buying and selling and making gain there at the temple. And that wasn't right. Jesus already, at the beginning of his ministry, cast out these money changers. But then in Matthew 21, toward the end of his ministry, he does this twice, doesn't he? He does it once at the beginning and the end of his ministry. And they asked him the question, "By what authority are you teaching and casting out these money changers?" That's what they meant by this. "By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?" That's when he asked the question, was the baptism of John from heaven or from men? And then they realized what kind of conundrum they were in. They realized if they said if the baptism of John was from men, all the people held John as a prophet. But if they said from heaven, he'll say, "Well, why didn't you obey him?" And so that's exactly the conundrum they were in. And Jesus would simply say, "Well, if you can't tell, then I'm not going to tell you by what authority I do these things." And they weren't able to really judge authority as much as they thought they were. And Jesus actually made them to see that very plainly by this question. But he said, "The baptism of John wasn't from heaven or from men." And so the voice of authority is speaking to us today. And some reject that authority, but we must not reject when Jesus speaks. In Matthew 28, verse 18, Jesus, after he went to the cross, his final words practically to his disciples was, "And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, 'All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth.'" That's when he tells them to go out and make all disciples of all the nations. We read verses 19 and 20 already. But that's the voice of authority for us today, that we're to go out and continue the things of God and do what he says, because Jesus is that authority. And we understand all authority has been given to him. And that's the name of authority for what we do in practice, in our worship, in our word, and our deeds. Colossians 3, verse 17 tells us, "Whatever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father." And that is telling us plainly what kind of name is authority, that Jesus has all authority when it comes to religious matters. We have to leave that where it is. We don't have authority among ourselves. Jesus is the voice of authority. And if he did not say to do something, and we're simply adding to or taking away from God's word, again, we're not the authority. We can't do that and be right with God in any way. Then we look at Jesus as the voice of invitation. And that's one of the things Jesus says, "Come to me," in Matthew 11, 28 to 30. Here's this wonderful invitation to those Jews that were living then. They could physically come to him, but they also come to him spiritually. In Matthew 11, verse 28, "Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, my burden is light." That's the invitation still open today. If we will come to Jesus, come out and step out in faith and turning away from sin and living for Him. Now, that's an invitation that's conditional, isn't it? It's based upon our changing, doing what Jesus says. It's not on our terms, but on Jesus' terms. Luke 9, verse 23 tells us, those, He said, who would come and follow Me must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow Me. And so we must do that, don't we? We must deny self and give up sin and live the way Jesus has for us to live. That's a voice that says, come, but you need to follow Me on My terms in this invitation. Matthew chapter 23, verse 37 to 39. Here's one of the passages of Scripture that haunts us, because it's talking about the Jews and how that they rejected their Savior and how that they needed salvation, but yet they were ones who turned their back on Jesus. And the Bible tells us, verse 37, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together the way a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were unwilling. Verse 38, behold, your house is being left to you desolate. For I say to you, from now on, you will not see Me until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Here Jesus wanted them to come, but yet they weren't willing. He wanted to gather them like a chicken gathers her chicks, her hen, gathers her little ones. But Jesus says, it's up to you, but you did not want to come. That's a free will, isn't it? That says about what we come in Jesus, come to Him on based upon our free will and ability to choose Him. And we need to choose Him. Here in Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, it's talking about people of God who had once been faithful, but for some reason they had chosen to be unfaithful. And at one of the churches there, he's talking, he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hears My voice and opens the door, I will come to him and will dine with him, and he with Me. And so Jesus wants that fellowship again restored, but yet He's on the outside waiting to come back in. Their choice to let Him in. Incidentally, those doors had a latch on the inside, but not on the outside for safety purposes. As we know, we lock our doors from the inside to keep intruders out. Well, Jesus is knocking on that door, but He's wanting in, but that person on the inside has to let them in. That's why we have to choose to have Him in our lives and keep Him in our lives, as we often want to do. But Jesus is the voice of discipline as well. Well, some might say, well, how could Jesus be the voice of, I thought He was all love and good deeds and kindness and simply teaching everybody to get along. Well, Jesus was, but also think about some of the things He said to those religious rulers. In Matthew 23, if you're still there, He talks about some of the most scathing rebukes. You know what He's doing is disciplining them. He's telling them exactly what they need to hear, even though it was unpleasant. Sometimes that's the way discipline is. It's unpleasant. And in Matthew 23, He says, verse 16, woe to you, blind guides, who say, whoever swears by the temple, that is nothing. Whoever swears by the gold, the temple is obligated. Verse 17, you fools and blind men, which is more important, the gold or the temple that sanctified the gold? Now, He says some things. He uses the idea of them being fools and blind. Now, why does Jesus say that? Some might say, well, that doesn't sound like Jesus. You know, we say something that rebukes and we're very stern in our words about this. Well, that doesn't sound like Jesus, but that does sound like Jesus. If we are trying to discipline and correct when there's things that need to be corrected. Even in Revelation 3, 14 to 18 talks about this as well. He refers to the church there, one of the churches that needed to repent because they were on a bad path. And you think about that. When churches go awry, and we can go awry, that what we need to do is come back to God in faithfulness. I want to begin with verse 14. Says, to the angel of the church in Laodicea write, the Amen and the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God, says this, I know your deeds, that you are neither cold nor hot. I wish that you were cold or hot. So because you are lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spit you out of My mouth. Because you say I'm rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing, you do not know that you are wretched, miserable, and poor, and blind, and naked. He's talking about their true condition here in this particular passage. Verse 18, I advise you to buy for me gold refined by fire so that you will become, may become rich, and white garments so that you will clothe yourself, and that the shame of your nakedness will not be revealed, and eye salve to anoint your eyes so that you may see. But here's the point, the last verse, verse 19, says, those whom I love, I reprove and discipline. That's the New American Standard version of that particular scripture. So therefore be zealous and repent. And that tells us a lot about if we are on the wrong side of this. We're on the side that needs to be corrected. Our job is simply be zealous and repent, because we want Jesus to discipline us, to change our ways. If we're being, might say, lost and are doing some things that are sinful on this side of eternity, we want Jesus to correct that or help us to correct that now rather than later. So Jesus needs to be that voice of discipline to us in our lives. And you know, that doesn't go against the idea of love, does it? When we correct our children, we do that in a loving manner because we want our children to grow up and do what's right. So Jesus is the voice of love. And he tells us exactly about that love in John chapter 3. Remember when Jesus was talking to Nicodemus? He says in verse 14, John chapter 3. I want to begin with verse 14. Here the Bible tells us, as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up. And so that whoever believes will in him have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. So Jesus is proclaiming God's love, that God so loved this world that you and I are in, that even though our condition is one of sin and condemnation and disgrace, that voice of love says, I'm not going to let you stay that way, that I'm going to lift you up out of the sin and the bondage and the muck and mire of sin and help you to be established, to be once again right in the sight of God. In John 13, verse 1, the Bible says about his disciples that Jesus loved his disciples even before he would go to the cross. He says he loved them to the end. And in John chapter 13, verses 34 and 35, he teaches us how to love and to be loving. And that's a badge of discipleship, isn't it? It says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. By this, all men will know that you are my disciples if you have love for one another. And that speaks volumes about how people look at us. If we're unloving, if we're unkind when we should be kind, but that's what love is. It's kind, and it's like what Romans, or actually 1 Corinthians 13 speaks about, the great passage of love, and how there's a lot of things and qualities of love. And then when people see that, they'll either say, well, that's the people who follow Jesus. Or they'll say, you know, those people are so cruel and unkind, and they don't love anyone. But again, they may have ideas about love that are not true to the Word of God when they say that. But if it's honestly, if we are the ones that actually do not do what we should do, then we are really guilty of that crime, of not being loving. But I'll tell you that love, true love, will help us to get to heaven when this life is over. In Mark chapter 10, the Bible even tells us that Jesus loved the rich young ruler, even though he gave up, you might say, his chance to go to heaven by turning away from Jesus. And I think about Jesus as the voice of condemnation. That's one of the things the Bible says that will happen if we are to hear the voice of Jesus. Which way do you want it to be, of salvation or condemnation? We'll talk about the salvation here in just a few moments. But it says, I want to go back to John chapter 5, if you will. John chapter 5, we see on the chart there, I have depart from me, accursed ones. We'll get to that passage in a moment. Just put a tab right there, and we'll go back to that in a moment. But in John chapter 5, I want to look at the end of this lesson, really what began this lesson. We'll go back up to verse 22, but let's look what it says in verse 22 of John chapter 5. The Bible says, for not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment to the Son, so that all will honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and does not come into judgment, but has passed out of death into life. Now, that's what we need to do, is believe what Jesus says. And I think that's more simply more than mental assent. It's about following up. It's a saving faith that acts upon that faith. It's not just simply mental assent. I believe God and Jesus. It's one who follows him every day. The Bible tells us here, it goes on to say, and verse 24, truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word believes in him. Verse 25, I should say. Truly, truly, I say to you, an hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Now, I read this before, or similar to this. He's talking about, I think, spiritually here. He's not talking about physically. He actually starts out with the spiritual, goes to the physical of this. He's talking about right then. There's people who are listening to me that are sound of my voice, and they're beginning to live, not physically, but spiritually, for the first time, you might say, in some regards. But then it goes on to say, verse 26, for just as the Father has life in himself, even so he gave the Son also to have life in himself. And he gave him authority to execute judgment because he is the Son of Man. And the Bible tells us, verse 28, this is why Jesus would say, do not marvel. He said, do not marvel at this, for an hour is coming in which all who are in the tombs will hear his voice. And he's really saying this because, don't marvel, because here I'm saying this, and this person becomes alive spiritually. Now this person's going to hear my voice, and they're going to come out of the grave, which is even farther. It's something hard for us to think about, because one day all of us are going to hear what Jesus says, come out of the tomb, come out of the grave. And the Bible tells about a good resurrection of the righteous or of the just, and there's one of the unjust, and that is to condemnation. That's one of the sad things about this is that some people will hear Jesus, but they will not want to hear what he has to say, because he's going to say, depart from me, you cursed ones. As Matthew 25, verse 41 tells us, then he will say to those on his left hand, depart from me, accursed ones, into eternal fire, which has been prepared for the devil and his angels. As we know, heaven is a place prepared for a prepared people. But so is the place called hell, a place prepared for the devil and his angels. And we don't want to go there. We don't want to stand in condemnation of God and Jesus in that day, as he's going to be the one that's presiding over our case. We think about what that means. Similar language in Matthew 7, 21 to 23, they'll hear the same words, depart from you workers of lawlessness or iniquity, as verse 23 tells us. And so Jesus is going to condemn based upon our deeds or our misdeeds, things that we've done in the past that we don't have the blood of Christ covering those deeds, because we rejected our Savior, because we turned our back on the gospel power to save us. But then what about the other side of the voice of salvation, where it says, come, you are who are blessed to my Father. And we know what that means. Matthew 25, verse 34, it talks about that idea of coming to him. Come, inherit the kingdom prepared from the foundation of the world. And he gives the reason why, Matthew 25, because they did what God said, the will of the Father. In Matthew 25, verse 46, at the conclusion of that, he says, these will go away into eternal punishment. That side of condemnation is going away into eternal punishment. But the righteous into eternal life. That's a sobering thought, isn't it? To think about, which voice are we going to hear when Jesus comes? Is it going to be one that says, come to me, come inherit the kingdom, or going to say, depart from me, and you workers of iniquity, or depart from me, you accursed ones? When we think about that, that's a very sobering thought. And that's really based upon what I do right now, or you do right now. It's based upon your deeds and what the blood of Christ, whether you've had that applied to your life in obeying the gospel or not, because salvation and condemnation is exactly that point. You may think, why? Because in John chapter 10, Jesus states there something about this idea of following him, listening to his voice in regard to matter of that. Verse 27 says, my sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. And I will give eternal, and I give eternal life to them. And they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. Those are words of comfort if we are following Jesus, if we're listening to his voice and obeying what he says. Because that's the basis, isn't it, of eternal life, is that we have to do the will of the Father, Matthew 7, verse 21 tells us. And so have you put on Christ? Mark 16, verses 15 and 16, Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He who believes and is baptized shall be saved, but he who believes not shall be condemned. And so whether we make this choice or not, we might say, well, I don't know if I want to make this choice. Well, you're making it by default by not obeying the gospel. Right now, all of us, without the blood of Christ, would stand condemned. But with the blood of Christ, the Bible tells in Romans chapter 8, now there's no condemnation. Those are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. And so we have to follow Jesus and obey his teachings and be baptized for the remission of our sins in and partake of the blood of Christ. Hope you've enjoyed this lesson. Hope this lesson has been beneficial to you in some way to help you to follow the words of Jesus and to obey his teachings and live for him every step of the way. And if you need to obey the gospel, why not do that now? Why not take that time to do what the Bible says now before eternity begins? If you've enjoyed this lesson, reach out to us some way. Help us to be able to know that you've listened to this broadcast and be able to do what Jesus says and want to obey the gospel. We can help you do that. We'd love to help you to obey the gospel, be free from your sins. Until next time, have a good day and God bless.